Welcome to this year's, to the 2022 Radical Educator Speakers Series. This year's theme is Putting Abolitionist Leadership to Work. Maha Jacobs will offer a land acknowledgement.
Thank you, Dr. Gray. As we gather together, we would like to recognize that while we gather at Cal State University East Bay, located in Hayward, California, that we are gathered on the ethno-historical tribal territory of the intermarried Hakeen and Ergen Chukino Ohlone-speaking tribal group, who were the direct ancestors of some of the lineage enrolled in the Okema Ohlone tribe of the San Francisco Bay Area, and who were missionized into missions San Francisco, Santa Clara, and San Jose. I would like now to pass it to my colleague, Dr. Eric Haas.
Thank you, Dr. Jacobs, and welcome everyone to our fourth year of the Radical Educator Speaker Series. I'm the director of the doctoral program, Eric Haas, and it's important to remember that it takes many hands and lots of thoughtful preparation to host an event like this. So I first of all want to thank our department chair, Dr. Ardella Daly, our dean, Dr. Robert Williams, and our academic coordinator, Ms. Debbie Woods, for all of their help and support in making this happen. We also have a large collective, the Abolitionist Leadership Working Group, that is part of the background that's gotten us to this point today. And you see a number of the people involved, some of the central participants over more than a year of work together. This is also guided by our commitment and ongoing preparation to two things: 5 social justice principles, which include the power of transformative language, the transformation of systems, the empowering of minoritized perspectives, community solidarity, and critical reflection. And in addition to that, we have an evolving development of our abolitionist leadership principle, or our understanding of abolitionist leadership. And I want to read that briefly. So our current understanding and how we're trying to put it into place more generally in our program, and specifically through the Radical Educator Speaker Series, is that abolitionist leadership recognizes that schools are microcosms of an anti-Black carceral society, and that carcerality structures every part of our educational system. These carceral structures create dehumanizing conditions and have material or bodily consequences for Black children. Abolitionist leadership seeks to disrupt and dismantle the carceral state, and in its place, create school structures and practices that center, love, and affirm the full humanity of Black children and the Black community. Ultimately, abolitionist leadership seeks the universal and collective emancipation of Black communities and all oppressed people. And with that in mind, I want to turn this back to my colleague, Dr. Maha Jacobs.
Thank you, Dr. Haas. Welcome, everyone. We ground ourselves by asking the question, why are we here? We're here to dismantle and disrupt the white supremacist educational structures, reinforce the school-to-prison pipeline. We want to reimagine and create new systems which uplift Black joy and work with communities to build a better educational system. We do this because Black joy matters, Black bodies matter, Black children matter, and we do have hope. Now I will turn it over to my colleague, Stacey Southern.
Hi, thank you all for joining us here this evening. And thank you, Maha. Dr. Jacobs, I want to start us with a grounding activity. This evening, we want to recognize the transformational nature of this work that we are doing. And even names we recognize can be transformational. California State University East Bay has undergone such a transformation in its history. To its present name, California State University East Bay, its name represents all the people in East Bay. Instead of just being Hayward, California State University Hayward, California State University East Bay adopted this name so that it can encompass all the people of the East Bay who it serves. So right now, I want us to take the opportunity to put our names in the chat and recognize where our names come from and our own stories and how they represent our own journeys and how we achieved our names. Maybe there's a family story, and maybe we have taken on our own names and who they represent in ourselves. So if you want to do a chat waterfall and share your stories with us, if you will grant us this sacred story. Thank you. And in just a moment, we'll give us a minute to do that, and then I will pass on the next portion to my co-conspirator, Mel. Thank you all for sharing your sacred stories with us. So many wonderful stories to share and represent who we are gathered here this evening. And once again, I want to pass it on for the next portion this evening to Mel.
Thank you, Stacey. I'm Mel Potts, and in the vein of grounding ourselves in who we are and what our names represent, in 1971, Luis Valdez, considered the father of Chicano theater, wrote Pensamiento Serpentino. And within that work, a poem in Lakesh, based on the long philosophical poem based on the Mayan Quiche origin myth, El Popol Vuh. As we come together to rehumanize and give voice to the voiceless in education and schools, we recite in Lakesh. Tú eres mi otro yo. You are my other me. Si te hago daño a ti, if I do harm to you, me hago daño a mí mismo. I do harm to myself. Si te amo y respeto, if I love and respect you, me amo y respeto yo. I love and respect myself. And now it is my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Diana Recouvoir, who received her PhD in school organization and educational policy from the University of California, Davis. She has spent time working with and supporting students in various carceral spaces from juvenile hall to prison. Her work has included volunteering with the Sacramento Area Youth Speaks program as an annual summit crew leader and UC Davis's chapter of Get on the Bus. Her research looks at California's corrections to education pipeline and how community colleges are supporting students as they return to their communities from jails and prisons. Through the lens of global sustainable development, she examines the complex issues at the intersections of race, poverty, criminal justice, education, and health. She believes that there needs to be continued and increased investments in the community structures that serve those with unmet needs, and especially the institutions that can increase the social mobility of those living in poverty. In addition to her abolitionist leadership work, Dr. Recouvoir finds joy in her six-month-old niece, Sunday. During the talk, if any questions come up, please feel free to add them to the Jamboard provided. The link has been placed in the chat now. We are honored to work with and welcome Dr. Diana Recouvoir in this Radical Education Speakers event this evening.
Hi, everyone. First of all, I want to thank you for having me. Thank you to the Department of Ed Leadership from CSU East Bay. I really appreciated that naming activity. Let me share my screen here. I really appreciated that because it is sort of part of my introduction here. I think it's really important as part of abolitionist praxis to name and assert our various identities, especially those that we bring to the table of this work in particular. And these are sort of mine that I bring to the table. To me, abolitionism is all about dismantling harmful structures. And I think that is both internally and externally. I see that work as needing to begin within ourselves, really, in that in the ways that we look at our own histories, heal from our own traumas, and dismantle the unjust structures and ideologies that really permeate our own experiences and relationships. And when I say harmful structures, I want to be explicit and call out systems of oppression like white supremacy and patriarchy. And doing this work is really how we get to walking the walk of living with integrity so that we can then let that integrity lead us as we engage with the broader works of abolitionism in our communities. And I think that given the nature of the work, as well as the current state of our world, it is more important than ever to be grounded and in alignment with the truth and our values. And so professionally, my experiences started as an undergrad in Teach in Prison. I was able to tutor and work with incarcerated students at San Quentin. And those experiences changed my life. It really shook me to my core and changed my career trajectory. At the time, I was an English major and thinking about pursuing a PhD in English. But after those experiences, I recognized the privilege in being able to choose that work over this, and I couldn't justify it to myself. And so since then, I've been trying to really gain knowledge and insight in any ways that I can. And then on the other side, in Chinese, my name is He Tingyan, or in Cantonese, Ho Teng Yin. And I am a queer Chinese immigrant. I came to this country when I was 5 months old. I was raised primarily by my grandmother and her stories as an educator in rural China. I was an ESL student when I started in California schools, and I had attended 16 different schools by the time I was in high school. I have family and friends who have been impacted by the justice system and have incarceration histories. And I'm a mother of a son who experienced discipline issues throughout his schooling. Next, I wanted to present a few key concepts just to get us all on the same page so we can even, you know, dive into the thing. A focus of mine is sustainable development. And this is the broad definition. And it was through this report that it really, the concept of sustainable development came into our global vernacular. And it's important because it's become a pretty hot topic and people engage in development activities, especially considering like climate issues. They like to use the term sustainable development a lot, but I would like to emphasize that in the original report, the commission saw eliminating poverty as being a central goal embedded within sustainable development practices. And they also named education institutions as being critical to this work because education has that promise of training and social mobility, right? And over the years, scholars have essentially critiqued this concept as like most people engaged in this work have mostly been ignoring the things that are inconvenient to their bottom lines. Namely, people are not addressing poverty in meaningful ways, and natural resources are not being managed in ways that will guarantee the needs of our future generations. Next, we have abolitionism and working toward an abolition democracy. You already have a wonderful definition of your own for abolitionist leadership. And you know, this is really a concept that was espoused by W.E.B. Du Bois as his critique of the failures of Reconstruction after the Civil War and the emancipation of Black Americans. And this was elaborated by Angela Davis in this like great work. And since then, it can be identified as an organizing framework that can be found throughout in a range of spaces and multiple disciplines, like from law to sociology, to education, to grassroots organizing and beyond really. And the school to prison pipeline we all are familiar with, and here it is really mentioned as a reference to the corrections to education pipeline, which is where my work is located. My work focuses on building pathways along this pipeline, and I call it restorative construction because I'm borrowing from restorative justice principles of like focusing on community and relationships and making amends, right? And so in this framework, we can see that one, we acknowledge that the school to prison pipeline has caused harm and is continuing to cause harm to our youth and has impacted our situation with mass incarceration. And so construction the other way, I call it restorative construction. And this is a way of trying to address the harm that is being wrought by the school to prison pipeline directly by building pathways on the other side, right? So that folks who are transitioning back into our communities from jails to prisons have proper support to succeed. And finally, loving praxis. This one's actually a big one. I didn't think that love could really be a serious and professional undertaking until I attended my first AERA. There was a panel on pedagogies of love. Shout out to scholars from San Francisco State, Allison Tintiago Cabales, Sean Jenwright, and Antuia Combe, who presented that year and really just opened my eyes and showed me the ways, some of the ways that critical love could be manifested in the work of decolonizing ourselves, the relationships we build with other people, and the work we do in our communities. And far from being hokey, I think this is where we can find our strength to persist when we are faced with a lot of the challenges and fights that we might encounter in this work. I think about Dr. Stovall's talk last month and the challenges that he presented to the community for being brave and committed in this work. And I agree. And through this framework of loving praxis, we can then translate those principles into concrete actions and ways of interacting with others. For example, I think it is easier to be brave when we stand in the conviction that the work we are doing affirms the dignity and humanity of everyone. Everyone deserves a historically accurate education. Everyone's identity should be visible and valuable. On my mind are the issues facing our curriculum around ethnic studies and CRT and LGBTQIA issues. Florida just passed last week their legislation called Parental Rights in Education, which colloquially people are calling it the Don't Say Gay Bill, which it essentially prevents the teaching of LGBTQIA issues for grades K through three. And this ultimately stigmatizes queer identities and tries to silence educators by threatening litigation. Just this morning, I heard a report about this, and there was a gay Florida educator who said, "I am not teaching my kids to be gay, but I am trying with all my power to teach them to be okay with who they are." This educator added that he and allies plan to keep doing what they're doing, and if they get sued, so be it, because what they're doing is right. And God, that just struck me, because that's what loving praxis and abolitionism looks like. It is also through loving praxis that we can try and engage with perceived opponents. It's the difference between calling someone out and calling them in, as Smith College Professor Loretta Ross says. It's the difference between reacting defensively and responding with curiosity, because I think that most people want to believe that they are good and they are doing the right thing. And I think that if they are truly not, loving praxis dictates that we try and show them why. At worst, I think we get ignored. At best, we might gain a partner in this work. And I think that, and to me, that's always worth it. I think the idea of ancestor and family are, these ideas are percolating in our collective consciousness. I'm thinking about the movies like Encanto or Turning Red, both movies, animated movies that deal with intergenerational trauma in different ways. And I saw so many parallels between this concept of ancestor and abolitionism that I wanted to build on this concept into a concrete organizing framework. And so when I think about being a good ancestor, I think it involves doing the hard work of breaking intergenerational trauma and injustice, choosing to reckon with and heal from histories of violence and then supplanting harmful patterns with loving ones. And I think that the concepts of sustainable development, abolitionism, and critical love are embedded within this framework and ways of being. And I think this framework is probably easier to understand within, you know, ourselves and our families, just in terms of our own children, if we have them, and wanting to change and be better for them, wanting to leave a legacy or inheritance for family. And like I said earlier, this work always starts from us individually, and then from there we can decenter ourselves and move outward toward a more expansive conceptualization of both community, family, and ultimately inheritance and who is deserving of it, right? So why education? We have been grappling with mass incarceration for a while. We have the reputation of being sort of the best at the wrong thing here. California, a lot of reforms have been driven by big court cases that really showed us that prison overcrowding was cruel and unusual punishment. And a way that California responded to that was through the realignment in 2011, where the shift of supervision of the non-non-nons, as they're called, which is non-serious, non-violent, non-sexual offenders, from state parole supervision to county probation supervision. And what this did was, you know, it shifted a lot of the responsibility to the counties, and suddenly communities all over the state were trying to grapple with what to do with their expanded incarcerated populations. And around the same time, there was also this landmark study, right, that showed such amazing value to correctional education, that participation in any correctional education program reduced recidivism by 43%, and that participation in a college program reduced it by 53%. Participation in correctional education increased a person's ability to be employed upon release by 13%. And ultimately we get $5 back for every dollar we put in correctional education. And California has definitely been investing in this pipeline in various ways. And so next I wanna give you sort of a big aerial view of our higher education infrastructure. We'll start at the community college, and it is the largest system in the nation. There are 116 campuses, 52 of which currently have programs that serve these students. Across the Cal State University system, we have Project Rebound. And there are currently 14 campuses out of 23 that have it. And across the UCs, it's the Underground Scholars Initiative. And there are 8 out of 9. Campuses that have that. Under the community college, I should mention that it's also organized under the auspices of the Rising Scholars Network. And this didn't happen until early last year. And so we'll shift and take a closer look at California's community colleges. I chose to focus on this system really because they're a critical access point for justice-involved students. We have, like I said, 116 campuses across the state. They are broad access institutions, which means, you know, you don't really get rejected from it. There are ways to fund your education through, like, the California College Promise Grant, right? And there is a community college located near all of the state prisons, and approximately 90% of jail inmates live within 10 miles of a community college. This is huge. And so when I started studying this system, it was completely decentralized. So the Rising Scholars Network didn't exist yet. It really started after Rebecca Silbert, who was part of the Renewing Communities Initiative that drove a lot of growth in this pipeline. She actually started working for the Chancellor's Office to like run this network essentially and help build it out, which is fantastic. And to give you a sense of the growth, the original Renewing Communities Initiative, it was basically, it was all foundational funded. It was like a $6 million request for proposal process. And it just drove so much growth, particularly related to face-to-face instruction for incarcerated students. In 2014, only San Quentin was providing classes in person. By 2017, there were face-to-face classes at all 34 state prisons. So this growth is why I'm taking a look. And also a few years ago, the state also infused another $5 million into development for this pipeline. And so here is just the numbers. Out of 116 campuses, 64 do not have programs to serve formerly incarcerated students. But out of those campuses, 11 have programs for incarcerated students. What that means is students from those particular colleges can take classes inside, usually through a correspondence model, but then on the outside, there's no support. There's no continuity. So, I think it's morally reprehensible to build programs in this way. And two, from just a purely program development and sustainability perspective, there's a lot of waste and missed opportunities for actually making the education that people are getting inside meaningful, right? And so the other half, we have 45% or 52 campuses that have programs for formerly incarcerated students. And to break that down, we see that 7 of them are completely informal programs. This means that they primarily rely on student clubs to support students. Another 7 are in development, meaning programs have been announced and they are being put together, but they're not official yet. And then 38 campuses or 33% have what I would call formal programs. And if we had time, I would dig into it. There's a lot of variation amongst formal programs in terms of what students can expect. And after I got like the broad landscape of what we're looking at across the state, I really wanted to take a closer look at one community to understand what it looked like. Because I know that the story is more complicated. So I chose to do a case study, and it was on a Southern California community college. This image here is an aerial shot to give you some context for this community. You can see that it is largely agricultural. There are two notable things. One is that there are 3 institutions for higher education in this community. You have the community college here, and then you have these 2 blue dots, which represent a private for-profit college or university, and then another private religious college. So for most people who live here, the community college is the best, easiest access to higher education. All the red dots, I will note that it is flanked by 2 state prisons. And then we also have, you know, the county jail and juvenile hall, but there are also multiple law enforcement agencies throughout the county that represent all sorts of like ICE and whatever, right? So this is, you can see the ways that the carceral state is literally just surrounding this community. For my case study, I chose portraiture as my methodology. And I organized my findings essentially as a series of vignettes, which were stories of how the folks at the institution were serving these students from inside all the way out. And I wish I had more time to really dig into it, but it was kind of a big, it was a big study. I ended up speaking with, I interviewed over 10 people, and we spoke for over 12 and a half hours. And the folks were very kind and sent me all kinds of other program and course metrics for the times that they had these programs. So it was very, very rich. But what I will, I'll give you like sort of the best highlights from each, which is for this community, it really started with Fiona. Fiona developed the Inside Out program as a EdD student at a local CSU. It was a labor of love. She was someone that worked in probation in like the 80s. And she had a long history of service. She used a lot of her own social capital and network to even get it off the ground. And she started development of this space. Like, this was a program for her doctoral program. And she wasn't supported at all. So she actually had to do a lot of the sort of grassroots fighting that a lot of program development doesn't really have to do right now. Fiona ended up quitting, essentially leaving her EdD program, all but dissertation, so that she could dedicate all her time to her students inside the jail. She told me repeatedly that she couldn't sacrifice that work. And so that's where she spent her time. In terms of program development, there was a lot of great support and leadership in this community. From the top, right? And those leaders really acted as protective factors for staff and faculty doing the work and students. I think this is where abolitionist leadership comes in a lot. And expanding programs for incarcerated students, they grew programs a whole bunch. Like, it started with just the jail program, and then they trickled out to a couple classes at the prisons, and then it became like dozens of classes and like degree offerings. So there was a lot of growth here, which is super admirable. But again, I would say that there was a lot of focus on building programs at this end and less so on the other end, supporting students as they went back home, right? One best practice that came out of this was warm handoffs, which was something that was born also out of Fiona. Fiona would literally walk students who were leaving the jail to the community college and introduce them to folks on campus who would then help them and provide them with resources. This community was doing some amazing things in terms of serving their students' basic needs. When the college, well, first, when I collected data, we were basically in the throes of COVID. I conducted interviews, a lot of Zoom interviews with folks. And so they were sort of contending with both the thing that they were doing and also expanding it so that they could help as many of their students as possible. And so they have a really large food pantry system. They have their own farms where they hope to, in the future, also grow their own to feed their own. But they also had like housing projects on campus that they were developing for students experiencing housing insecurity and homelessness. And that was huge, right? And in terms of serving formerly incarcerated students, there was a lot of support. Again, like folks from all levels, and I spoke to the interim Dean of Student Equity and Student Achievement, and folks who ran, who first developed this program and then who took it over. During my interviews, there was a reorganization so that these programs went to different folks. And a lot of the work that they have been doing has been around disrupting stigma, pushing back when there's people who, you know, have unwarranted fears about our students' histories, right? And then the student organization, I ended up speaking with three students, all student leaders, and they, each of them were struggling to survive with very difficult circumstances, but they were all highly motivated. And I want to do a thing that I don't typically do, which is discuss, and I ended up discussing in my case study, that a couple of my students had a background of, like, their criminal criminal justice involvement involved sex crimes. And it is important here because it impacted both their experiences on campus and their abilities to just thrive, period. Like, one, we know that this is a super sensitive area, and some of the, like, it's highly triggering for a lot of reasons, right? But what matters is that they both serve their time and were doing all the right things. There was complicated issues about whether they even committed the thing that they were accused of, etc. But on the outside, it didn't, none of the complicated details matter, because all people see is the record and also the fact that they can be looked up in a sex offender registry. And for these students, like one student, my female student, she was a woman in her early 30s. And this was something that happened like a decade ago. And the label that is on the sex offender registry is like super basic. And so when people saw it, it automatically instilled fear. And that fear led to a lot of harassment, and the student like essentially isolating herself and not wanting to engage with the community at all. And also it matters because certain crimes have with it the collateral consequences of those crimes, which means that it makes them ineligible to work in certain fields. And for some of these students, they were pursuing education in fields that they couldn't viably even work in or be licensed in. And I think as educators and as folks, you know, trying to build programs, we need to make sure that we're providing the proper academic counseling so that students aren't wasting their time. Yeah, I mean, Isabel essentially was surviving because she was doing a lot of work as an independent contractor with the skills that she had gained in her classes. Like, even though she couldn't be properly licensed as like even a cosmetologist with her offense. And COVID threw everything up into upheaval. It caused the all the classes that they were providing for incarcerated students ended up being converted into correspondence classes. The school didn't even have a correspondence education policy, and they had to write it. And what that meant was, during COVID, all of the folks who were involved in the program ended up being TAs for the program. They were doing, like, all of their time was spent doing logistics and administrative work and, like, Xeroxing textbooks and delivering, running errands to institutions and stuff like that. So you can imagine how that impacted serving these students generally. I know that we are running out of time, so I don't want to go on too long. I'm going to make my slides available to folks who are interested, so you can dig into them, email me questions, whatever, we can engage further, because I put together kind of a talk that was way too dense, mostly because I was so excited and I wanted to share knowledge. So forgive me. I'm going to just, here are some major lessons from the field that I just kind of threw out there because I thought they were important. But let's skip ahead. Before today, I managed to get a hold of a few students from your community and talk to them about their experiences and things that they might need in this particular context, which is something that is super important to me. And the first person I spoke to wants to remain anonymous. She is a Black woman, they're all former sociology students. She was also an AOD certificate student. She was involved in the Level 5 Club for formerly incarcerated students, which was kind of the only thing that I found that mentioned formerly incarcerated students. And so when I spoke to her, I learned that they had approximately 7 club members at all times. And they tried to get momentum going, but it didn't really work. It at times felt bigger than it was because they were super involved in the broader organizing in the state for these programs. So they were attending conferences and getting some press time. And so it felt bigger, but they were really struggling. She told me that students could not trust their faculty advisor in this club, that he was a Black professor who often degraded students in front of them. She experienced and witnessed racial microaggressions and aggressions while as a student, both from this person and also from others. Although she was an ally, she was not a formerly incarcerated student. She experienced a lot of dehumanizing practice in the institution as it relates to things like financial aid, right? Just things that were causing her as a person who had experienced a background of poverty and trauma around finances to constantly experience anxiety because financial aid was not dispersing things on time or was there were a bunch of hiccups that she was talking about. And she actually, when we spoke, was also dealing with something. It must have been a student loan repayment that was also having some technical issues. And from her experience, we get to just the need for us to really align ourselves in policy and practice, right? To make sure that everything is actually the simple things, that our students don't have to worry about the simple things, that it doesn't throw them into turmoil when they are already struggling with an overwhelming amount of other things in their lives. Another student I spoke to was Marlo. He's Black and he was a 4.0 student. He was released from prison in 2007 and he's currently a motivational speaker and truck driver. He ended up paying for his tuition completely out of pocket because there was no funding for felons. And because there was no funding, he, got in and got out as fast as he could. I also spoke to Alex, who's a white current student with a 4.0 GPA. He was released from prison in 2019, and he's currently also a full-time substance use disorder counselor. And he is someone who tells me that he is happy and thriving. But he acknowledges both his privilege as a white man and also his ability to navigate these institutional spaces. When he first started his college path, he started at a local community college, and he got so he showed up at the admissions office or whatever, and they sent him back and forth across the campus a few times, to the point where he was so flustered and so frustrated with the whole process, he stopped in front of her and said, "Do you want me to fuck off?" Excuse the language. Because that's what he felt, that they didn't want him there. And he said, like, "If you don't want me here, just tell me and I will go." And it wasn't until then that they were like, "Okay, let's take a breath." And they walked him to where he needed to go. Again, that's that warm handoff, right? And so from these three students, these are the sort of needs that they mentioned that would be helpful for other justice-involved students. The two students who actually did have justice involvement recognize that these resources won't help them, partly because they don't need them because of their own whatever personal abilities, right, and privileges. But just equity and consistency in policy and practice. They wanted a mentorship program. This was something that Alex particularly talked about a lot. And this is a thing that could help with a lot of the processes that are confusing with transfer and enrollment, navigating resources, et cetera. And in particularly outreach, engagement, and destigmatizing justice involvement, right? Access to legitimate healthcare, mental health care is super important. I would say not exclusive to just these students, but everyone. And funding for felons. Because at the community college level, students can have their education funded, but at other levels, there's less access to resources. And Marlo particularly talked about how there are folks that he knows who ended up dropping out because they couldn't afford to pay for school the ways he did. He also recognized his own privilege and being able to like become a truck driver to survive. I do have good news, and Project Rebound is coming to CSU East Bay. Dr. Eileen Barrett and Dr. Julie Beck have been working really hard on the proposal so that East Bay can join the CSU Project Rebound Consortium. And if you're granted probationary status this spring, these are the resources that will be available this coming fall. And I'm not gonna read them to you. Instead, I will just say that I think we're living in this constant state of existential crisis between the pandemic, climate change, an increasingly destabilizing geopolitical climate, and the impacts of white supremacy. We're faced with like blatant Orwellian doublespeak all the time. You know, war is peace, freedom is slavery, ignorance is strength. From power holders who can control how information is accessed and who can access it. I don't know about you, but I kind of think that it's even more important in moments like these to really be steadfast in our commitments to the truth and to being a good ancestor. Political climates and dominating ideologies may vacillate, but I believe firmly in the stories that can be found in the data and the truths that are revealed despite rhetorical obfuscation. For our purposes, the big ones here are that mass incarceration and associated policing practices are unsustainable. Poverty is unsustainable, and these two issues are deeply interrelated, meaning most of the folks caught up in the justice system are there for crimes associated with poverty. Education, and I want to be clear and inclusive of all educational pathways, are one of the most effective ways of reducing recidivism. And there has already been a lot of investment in this pipeline, but how much of an impact these programs have depend on how they're developed, funded, and implemented. We need to get support to the students who need it. We need to be critical and intentional as we engage in the work of humanizing our educational spaces and the policies that govern them. And we need to work to understand how seemingly innocuous policies can be harmful to some of the most vulnerable students and commit to the work of either changing them or supporting students in spite of them. And this is my invitation to join me and try and be a good ancestor. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. McCor, for your presentation. Really appreciate it. Hopefully everyone has taken the few minutes that we've had the musical selections by Dre T. to put some questions on the Jamboard. I do see a couple of questions coming through on the chat. If you can move those right on over there to the Jamboard, that will be great. And Dr. Rinkelberg, thank you so much for your presentation. I have quite a few questions for you, and we have about 20 minutes, 23 minutes to go over this. One of the first questions that I wanted to ask you was that you mentioned formerly incarcerated students had to pay out of pocket, also mentioning funding. Can we have a brief discussion sort of about funding, so what funding sources might look like? Can the students get grants or things like that?
There are a lot of policies that essentially make a lot of students with, like, especially students with felonies, right, make them ineligible for a lot of this funding. So the typical ways that a person without justice involvement might get grants or things, those become out of reach. Mm-hmm. So, you know, folks end up taking loans and other, you know, the other ways that we like fund our educations. And right now, I don't really know what we can do about this. I think certainly a bunch of this also needs to happen in terms of the policies that we support as voters, right? Mm-hmm. And particularly involve like revolving around these students.
Okay. And I love that suggestion about as voters, you know, the power of our vote, you know, to make a difference. Thank you for that answer. I do have another question. What does the data indicate regarding students who go through educational programs and re-entry into the community and workforce system? What is that data looking like?
Honestly, there is very little like data on a lot of actual recidivism. Like there's so much work, but also not enough work in this area. And data, in particularly reliable data for employment outcomes, has always been hard to sort of get our hands on. Mm-hmm. In my work evaluating the career and technical education programs for the state prisons, we tried to get that data. We wanted to know, like, for folks being released, how much of an impact this was making. And honestly, it just wasn't being tracked. Like, wow. Folks weren't collecting the data. And this is one of the policy things that I really want to push for, is better and more transparency in terms of data collection, so that we can, you know, actually see what the impacts are.
Wow. Data tracking, that surprised me. So thank you for that answer. I was really surprised by that. We have another question along the similar lines. How can we better support our middle schoolers and high schoolers who are in or have recently exited the juvenile justice system?
Oof. Mm-hmm. I mean,
it's a tough one, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, this is where we need to put our abolitionist hats on, mm-hmm. and think about the sort of community structures that might benefit those particular youth. Developing maybe after school programs, mm-hmm. That could, and providing like free or low cost childcare, essentially, spaces where youth can hang out and be, have like pro social relationships and maybe homework help and things like that. It's those sort of structures, right, that we need to start building and making sure is part of all our spaces and accessible to everyone.
Okay. A question, also, this one is mine. I'm gonna jump line a little bit and ask my question. And so you mentioned the concept of being a really good ancestor, and I really like that. What are some ideas or some advice that you can give to sort of explain that to educators, families, or community members explaining this concept of being a good ancestor?
You know, honestly, when I thought about this, I thought about this more, it's a way for me to ground sort of all of these theoretical foundations into a framework that makes sense for me moving forward.
Mm-hmm.
And when I think about engaging others in this work, I think about coming at it, I mean, it needs to come from perspectives that make sense to the individuals you're trying to engage, right? And I, again, go back to just the points of affirming humanity and dignity in the things that we're trying to do and build always. Like, we are trying to reduce harm in our communities, right? And that's what the goal is. And being a good ancestor is that making sure that we are behaving in a way that guarantees our all of our youth can benefit from the promises of education. And I think that really comes from just having conviction in what you're doing, and refusing to back down when we are challenged by stakeholders.
Thank you, good answer, thank you. One of the other questions is, what would you like to see in a graduate program like our Department of Ed Leadership that would show that it is a living into sustainable development, abolitionist democracy, and pedagogies of critical love? What would you like to see in a program like ours?
I mean, I think you are already doing a lot of this work. I think just from the ways that your talk is structured and the sort of community building that you are trying to foster, this is all part of it, right? And it's just that, just constantly trying to push this work forward and extend it to the students in the program, right? Because you have that more global understanding and appreciation that these are future educational leaders who have an impact on their communities, their school communities, and all of those lives, right? And I don't know, I think just, I mean, it's already a good start.
Great.
Keep building and keep mm-hmm. reinforcing the need to be committed to this work.
Thank you, and to be committed, I love that. This question asks, why is there a movement of math and English classes from CC to adult schools in the Bay Area? Is this related to former incarcerated students coming into adult schools? Why is CC do not receive former incarcerated?
I'm not completely sure I understand.
Yeah, that's reading that one.
But I will say that there is a problem with the type of pathways, academic pathways mm-hmm. that we offer to justice involved students. Mm-hmm. And a really frustrating thing that I encounter is that a lot of the programs are housed in sort of the, you know, adult ed spaces that are like basic education programs. Mm-hmm. And it's limited. It likes to funnel students to, in particular, like AOD certificates and counseling and these types of career paths, which mm-hmm. on the one hand makes a whole lot of sense, but is it really equitable that we are only providing these options to these right. students, right? So I would say that, I know that that probably doesn't answer that question, but this is something to definitely pay attention to.
Mm-hmm. I think it does. From my understanding of the question, I think it really does answer the question. This one is, what can we do to change the policy that prevents students with records to become employed in some areas? And that is a question I was wondering during your talk as well, that some students are taking courses and sort of training in these particular programs that they legally can't get licensed for. What are some things that people can do to sort of really change some of those policies and some of those laws that exist that really isolate students?
Oh God, I mean, I feel like this needs to be a discussion with like legal scholars. The thing is, once something becomes like law or policy, it becomes really hard to change, right? And we need to continue to advocate for these things to change. And for like, and I think so much of this work comes down to destigmatizing criminal justice involvement, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. If we can shift that sort of public understanding and consciousness, mm-hmm. we can probably advance a lot more of these reforms that want to do away with things. Like, I mean, we are now more states are adopting ban the box okay. legislation, right? Where employers won't ask about justice involvement, and that helps. But there are also a lot of these like certificate programs and things that lead to careers that are unviable that we also need to change. And I know that like in communities, a lot of the employment opportunities end up being very individual. It's like folks who are willing to take a chance. It's always the exception, not the rule, which is a problem, right? Because when we think about programs for folks, we also see that where there are really great programs, it's because really passionate folks are committed to the work, and we can't legislate passion. Right. So we need to figure out ways to do away with these barriers and help people succeed.
And I love that answer because it goes right back to, you know, revolutionary action and movement, you know, to bring about some change. So thank you. Thank you for that answer. Appreciate it. So we have time for a couple more questions. I apologize to folks that I didn't get to all the questions. I'll move a little faster here. What advice do you have for the abolitionist work group in getting involved and support the Rebound program at CSU East Bay?
Oh, wow. I mean, I was just so excited to hear that this program was coming. I think hoping to get the word out is big. Your role as also helping to destigmatize is big. Alex, one of the students from East Bay that I spoke to said, you know, even signage like just put signs up that tell people that it's okay if you have a record, mm-hmm. That show me that my existence is okay on this campus, right? So like there, I feel like when we think about abolitionist praxis, it can manifest in so many different ways.
Beautiful, thank you. So one of the other questions that I have here is how can the COC develop the Project Rebound program? And so in other words, if you can sort of describe a little bit more about the program for the audience in terms of what's coming forward so people can have a really good idea of what it is that they would be helping to support.
Well, let's see, I'm gonna share screen again briefly so that I can go back to that one slide. Uh-huh. And so there's going to be offices opened in Robinson Hall. And it is going to be a safe, supportive, accessible, and stimulating space for students who have been formerly incarcerated. A program that situates students and their knowledge and experiences. The program will hire a program coordinator and staff with incarceration experience, which is wonderful because one of the most important things that the institution can actually do is provide employment opportunities for students. It is really hard for certain folks to get a job. And a lot of the support often comes in like job fairs that might provide opportunities to places that won't hire you after you actually apply. Right, so I'm just throwing that out there. Wraparound student services organized around holistic advising and peer support and one-on-one counseling that includes academic advising, financial aid, scholarship guidance, career and goal planning, graduate school advising, guidance on balancing academic and personal life. And it will be a program structured around peer support and it will help apply, persist, and succeed in their academic and extracurricular activities. So these were the like bullet points that I got my brain just, Dr. Beck and Barrett, sorry. Yeah.
Okay, wow, that was really helpful. And it gave some really practical steps that people can actually do to help support, and even some things that can happen on campus to help support. So we are actually out of time. I apologize that there's a couple of questions that I didn't get a chance to get to. So I do appreciate your presentation and the Q&A. Thank you so much, Dr. Rickenberg, for all your hard work, your deep studies. It's much appreciated. So without further ado, one more question. Okay, so we can do one more question. Looks like I can take one more. So here's something that's a good question. What was your biggest learning personal transformation from your work and relationships with justice-involved students? A study of the school to prison nexus. Sort of end with that reflection.
Biggest lesson. I think I will go back to my earliest experiences in a carceral classroom. So I was, it was my last semester at Berkeley. And I had very little experience with even though this thing is sort of everywhere, it's also kind of invisible, right? Like that is the insidiousness of the thing. So it's easy to go through parts of your life oblivious a little bit to some of the things that go on. When I went into this classroom and had the experiences I had with students, it really just changed my entire worldview and showed me how deeply pervasive these issues are and how they permeate sort of all facets of our life in society. When I came into this, I didn't really know where I wanted to go with my research. I wanted to make an impact. And I sort of studied it from everywhere, from school to prison, right? Like starting with our babies, and went everywhere before I landed here because I saw it as a restorative way to address the thing. But yeah, like just that realization of how deeply ingrained it is to sort of every fabric like of our society.
Wow, that is beautiful. That's beautiful. Thank you so much for sharing that personal piece. I really appreciate that. That is beautiful. Thank you. That is a great one to end on. And again, thank you so much for your time. I'm going to hand it over now to my sister, Winnie. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Diana Rakovor. Let's show some love. This was really deep conversation. So please show some love, do some emojis. This is really good. Thank you again for joining us in this learning space, for sharing your thoughts, your experience, your knowledge, deep knowledge, your love with us. For me, as I listened, I just thought I would do a quick recap for everybody. I really want to be a good ancestor. I want to affirm humanity and dignity. I want to be an active member of the abolitionist democracy. We're not just tearing down. We want to create new democracies. We want to build pathways, restorative construction. We want to focus on relationship. We want to make amends. And I want to be somebody who practices critical love. So thank you. Thank you for making this space humanizing for us and helping us learn from you tonight. And I want to thank everybody who joined us today. Thank you for being an active participant. Thanks for your questions. Thank you for the Abolitionist Working Group for putting this together and every day deepening our knowledge and our reason for why we're on this journey together. And with that, I wanted to kind of share what is coming up on April 27th on a Wednesday. Let's start with AERA. So we have AERA coming up on the 22nd of April. So if you can join us, that would be fantastic. On Wednesday, April 27th, we will have another radical conversation with Kazu Haga. So please join us. And he is the author of Healing Resistance, Working Towards Abolition of Violence. So thanks again for joining us and spending the time with us this evening. Thank you, and you have a good evening. And continue to engage in critical love.